If you remember back to earlier in the week during my mailbag, I opened up this little logic analyzer unit here, which was nice and super cheap. It's like a clone of the Saley logic analyzer. You can find these things all over the typical Chinese stuff sources, eBay, AliExpress, Banggood, all those guys, for incredibly cheap these days. And I'm gonna do a bit of tinkering around, a bit of playing with it. So what it does basically is it tells you if you've got on the eight input lines, it tells you if you've got a logic low or a logic high. And in the spec sheet, it calls out that the logic low is anything below about 1 1/3 volts, and a logic high is anything up to about 5.5 volts. So it basically just tells you low or high, or binary 1 or 0 if you prefer, on the eight lines. And then a ninth line is ground, and it's also got a clock input, which I haven't quite figured out yet. But I'll just show you some of the playing around I've done. It's not, this isn't a tutorial, this isn't massively educational, this is just me tinkering around. So the first thing you have to do is install a bit of software. The software that I'm using is a suite of software, of open source software, designed for a bunch of different logic analyzers. And within that, the actual logic analyzer piece is called PulseView. For my installation, it installed as just a package using the package manager that comes with my Linux distribution. I could have compiled it from source code and installed it that way, but that's way too hard for just messing around like what I'm doing, just experimenting. If I wanted the latest and greatest version of it, that would be the way to do it, but I don't care. I just wanted something to work, and it installed without any headaches whatsoever, just using the package manager. I didn't have to mess around with drivers or anything. It just worked. Apparently, the Windows version, you need to install a USB driver and a couple other things, but it's not the end of the world. So with that out of the way, here's what PulseView looks like when you fire it up. And I've got the device plugged in right now. So you just pick what device you're going to use. Say logic, it automatically sets itself to eight channels, and just sets up a generic default. Now, based on whatever frequency of signal you're getting, you can choose the appropriate sampling frequency. What I'm doing is quite low at the moment, so I'll just leave it there. And how many samples? You can do the math at 20 kilohertz, so 20,000 samples a second. You get 1 million samples, and you can sample, grab less samples if you're doing something really slow, or up to 500 giga samples or 1 tera samples if you want to, if you've got enough memory, if you're doing something fast enough that's got a long enough pattern. But for what I'm doing right now, I'm just going to go with 20 kilohertz. So, what I am actually, well, the first thing I'm going to show you, I'll show you a couple of different things that I've been playing with, is our old friend, the 4017555 circuit. So, what I've done is I've connected channel 0 to channel 6, or 1 through 7 if you prefer, up to the first 7 output LEDs, and I've put channel 8, or the last channel, onto the clock right here. So when I power this guy on with 5 volts, that's an important thing to remember. This thing maxes out at about 5.5 volts, so you don't want to give it any more than that because you risk letting the smoke out. That's important, but we're not doing power electronics here with it. We're doing digital logic. So, what I'm sampling, like I said, is the clock and the first 7 of the 10 LEDs. So these three are not being sampled. So when I go over to the software, and click run just to sample it and then stop it. And I could have let it go, and I'll zoom out here. And here we have a bunch of samples. Now you notice on here's the, oops, let me just zoom back a little bit. Come on. My laptop has a trackpad, not a mouse, so I'm kind of ginchy on it here. But anyway, so when I started recording, it was partway through the sequence. So let's just start from here. Here is LED number one, and the clock pulses down here. So when LED number one goes on, LED two number goes off, blah, 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 all the way down. And then, so this is one through seven. LED 8 comes on here, LED 9 comes on here, LED 10, and back to LED 1 again. One of the features in here is a cursors thing, so you can do that just to find out where things line up. I'm just going to do one full cycle there. So 586 milliseconds is, let's get this a little bit more precise. If I zoom in, I can get that more precise, but this is good enough for what we're doing here. So that shows that the transition happens right at the rising edge of the clock, and the rising edge of the first LED turning on is exactly the same time. And then each channel turns on and off imperceptibly fast right at the rising edge of the clock each time. That's kind of interesting. So we have 590 milliseconds for the whole sequence to happen. Let's get back into the center here. Or for a single LED to happen, let me zoom in here. Tighten that up just a little bit more. That's 57.5 milliseconds. That's close enough. So let's get a calculator up here. 1/0.05761 of a second equals a clock frequency, or a single pulse happening. Right, a single pulse is the same as one clock pulse. Of about 17.33 hertz. So let's see if that's right, how close that is actually. I'll just bring in my meter that's got a bit of a frequency counter built into it. So, ground and the clock. Ooh. 16.9, 17.0. That's really, really close to the value that we came up with. That's cool. And if I was to get those cursors a little bit more precisely aligned, you could probably get a little bit better answer there. 57.5 milliseconds. Anyway, so that's cool. You can watch what's going on in your circuit like that. On this thing, it's not as big a deal, but with a circuit that's moving a lot more, a lot quicker than you can see, then it would be a concern. Let's see what else we can play with this thing. So here we have a rotary encoder. I've always been sort of fascinated by these, but never really had many to play with until these ones showed up in a mailbag not that long ago. Rotary encoder basically is a device. It has three pins on one side. The one's a common pin, and the other two are basically just switches. And as this spins in one direction or the other, it turns the switches on and off at different times in different relations to each other. This particular one also has a little push-button clicky switch on it. That's not mandatory, but these three pins are what makes it a rotary encoder. So when I turn it in one direction, we'll see these two pulses going on and off at a different time in relation to each other. And we turn it the other direction, we'll see them turning on and off with that relationship changed. And then the width of the pulse is how fast I turn it. So I'm going to capture lots of samples just because I'm doing this manually. And I'm going to zoom out a little bit here. And we'll run that, and then I'll turn it in this direction. I'll stop. And I'll turn it back in the other direction. And I'll turn it slowly. And I'll turn it fast. And I'll stop that. And we'll zoom in on the first set of pulses here. So notice they, first of all, they both start off high. And then turning in the direction I was going, this first pin goes low while the second one's high. And then the second one goes low while this first one is low. So the first one, this one, always changes state before this one does, which indicates which direction we're going. And then the width of the pulses tells us the speed of it. So here is me turning it in the opposite direction. So now this this one goes low first, and then this one goes low during that time. You see this one goes low, and then before it goes high, this one comes low. Right? So now this one is always changing ahead. And this is where I turned it really slow. So the actual low pulse happens fairly quickly still. But the pulse width of the high is a lot longer. And then when I turned it fast, you can see it there. That's pretty cool. If I had that connected to a motor or something, I could actually measure its speed just by counting the pulses and doing the same math as I did before, one over time. So the next thing I'm going to play with is to take a look at the serial data that is being sent out of my Arduino to run my WS2812, aka NeoPixel strip here. So this is just one of the demo sketches that came with the library. Nothing fancy, nothing I've tinkered. The only thing that I've adjusted on it is the length of the strip. Okay, so I've got my pin 3 connected up just through this as a fan out to the first channel of the analyzer and ground to ground. That's it. Let's see what happens when I sample that. Okay. So there's 10 million samples, sampled at 500 kilohertz. So that took 20 seconds. Let's zoom in here. That's pretty dense data. Zoom, zoom, zoom. So it looks like it's happening in little bursts of data, and that makes sense because there will be a bunch of data sent out to the pixels, then a pause while, in order to display it, then a pause while it's displayed, and then a few milliseconds later. Well, let's see exactly how many milliseconds later. So there's the beginning of the one pulse, or the one burst of data, and there's the beginning of the other one, more or less. So it looks like about every 3.5 milliseconds, it sends out a burst of data, which is about 1.9 milliseconds long. Okay, so let's see what's inside. Turn those curses off. Inside each one of these bursts of data. Ah, so we can tell right now that it's breaking it up using a bit of pulse width modulation. And if you've ever looked at the data sheet for WS2811 or 2812, you'll see that the pulse widths matter and the timing matters. So at the beginning here, burst of data, we got some short high pulses, and then one that's essentially a square wave, so a longer pulse, and then some shorter pulses and medium length pulses, and on it goes. If you were to look at the data sheet, you could actually figure out what's being said in here. What it is basically it's sending signal RGB, red, green, blue channels, and an intensity for each of the LEDs in the strip. And then right at the end here, this stuff right at the end will be a command to display it. There is built into this thing a bunch of protocol decoders, and it says that there is one that works off serial to decode RGB LEDs using SPI. But I haven't figured out how to make it work yet, because all it's decoding out of here is basically a bunch of FF or binary 111111. So I still have to figure out how that decoder works for the RGB LED, because that would be pretty cool to be able to see it in there. There's probably some add-ons that I've forgotten to add on or whatever. I'll mess with that another time. If you wanted to do it the hard way though, you could go to the data sheet and look at just the binary and the pulse widths and be able to figure out what's going on in there. Let's see if I can find something else that I can actually use one of those protocol analyzers on to show what that looks like. So here's the last, the last thing I'm gonna show you, just to tinker around with this thing. It's a project that I built quite a while ago just to play around with the temperature probe and an LCD screen with an I2C on the back of it. And that's what we're interested in. The I2C, which talks using clock and data, two lines only, which are these two here, connected up to the logic analyzer. And then over on here, we can put in an I2C. I don't know why I have an SPI there. An I2C protocol analyzer. The clock, I think, is on 0, and the data, I think, is on 1. And stack decoder, do I need a stack decoder? I don't know. Let's just run this and see what happens. Okay, looks like we got a burst of data over here. And there's the protocol analyzer part doing its magic. It's found some bits and stuff. Let's zoom in on that and see what we can find. Okay. That's odd. So my little LCD display thing here, it's using 3F as its address on the I2C bus. And if we look in here, we can see that the very first thing in that burst of data after the sync pulse is an address right 3F, and then a right, and then some data 8C. With address right, more data, address, data, and on through that entire pulse. So if we were to go into the data sheet for that device, we could figure out exactly what's going on, and if it wasn't working, find out what's not working about it. The ones that you would probably want to look at in that case are the first few, which are going to be what sets up the screen to be written to properly. And if we dig down through the code for the program, What it's doing is basically four different things in the loop. LCD set cursor to position, or to row 8, column 0, I think, or is it column 8, row 0. And we print the temperature, so we print whatever the temperature variable is, and then set the cursor to 8,1, and then we print the humidity, and then we wait a second. Oh, we wait a second. Let's look at these bursts of data. I bet you if we put the cursors on them, we're going to find that they are really, really close to 1 second apart. Yeah, look at that. So that's just a quick how do you do on these cheap little logic analyzers. I think that could come in handy at some point for troubleshooting. It has a lot more protocols that it can do on here. It can do I squared C. It can do, what do we got here? Oh, we saw them in the list there. It can do one wire, CAN bus, couple of different infrared remote control standards. So you'd put these guys after the photodetector and probably an amplifier to bring them back, bring them up to the 5-volt range. And you could see what was coming in off the infrared. It can do SPI, parallel, JTAG, I squared C we saw, UART, USB. I was going to do show you USB, but I just didn't have the, didn't feel like putting the wires on, and my laptop probably couldn't handle doing that many different USB tasks simultaneously because it's old and busted. The other interesting thing, it can do Z80 protocol, the old venerable Z80 microprocessor. Or, like we started off doing, you can just look at the raw bits and figure it out your own self. Why make the computer do the thinking if you can make your own brain do it? Especially if you're doing something weird and off the charts. Anyway, there's this guy. Fun to play with. Thanks for watching. If you got anything to talk about, down in the comments down below. And if you have played with one of these and played with Sally or PulseView, and you've been able to get the NeoPixel or WS2812 protocol working, and you know what I did wrong, let me know, please, because I think I'm going to be using it, or I'd like to use it, to figure out what's going on in those things, especially when I get to using large numbers of them, which I hope to do at some point eventually.